Our next speaker is Jack Elwes. Jack is a world-renowned AI artist living and working in London. His speech is titled Deepfake Drag Queens, Curing the Dataset and Recontextualizing AI in New Media Art. Please join me in welcoming Jack.
Hello.
Hello, Jack.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Fantastic. So yeah, I'm Jake Elwes. I'm a media artist based in London. Actually, I'm just getting a bit of echo, so I'm just going to quickly see if I can change this. Sorry, 1 second. I think that's fine. So yeah, I'm Jake Elwes and I'm a media artist based in London. For the last 5 years, I've been experimenting using machine learning. So this image that you can see right now is actually very far removed from AI and machine learning. It's a circuit board that has been pushed through a printing press, an old Victorian printing press, at the art school that I studied at in London, the Slade School of Art, which is quite a traditional fine arts academy. So I'd like to briefly speak about a couple of the concepts in AI that first inspired me to, that first inspired me as an artist to experiment in this field. And for me, they're sort of deeply philosophical concepts, which I think kind of coming from a history of conceptual art and media art really interested me and excited me. So the first idea is this idea of a latent space. So I'm sure some of you might be familiar, especially if you come more from a technical perspective of what a latent space is and how it works. But for me, this was kind of groundbreaking when 5 years ago, I started to look at how classifier networks and facial recognition networks learn from large data sets of millions of images, could also be sound data sets or, data sets of any sort of data. But what I loved about this is the fact that you can think about this in a sort of spatial metaphor. So you can consider this latent space, which contains all of the information from your data set. And let's say that you train a classifier network to get really, really good at recognizing images of trees and birds and dogs and cats and all the different images and classes that you put in that original data set. What the neural network does is it takes all of that pixel data, runs it through the network, and it starts to plot all of these images and all of these effectively concepts that it has learned in a multidimensional latent space. So then when you give it a new image, it says this new image of a tree probably exists around here, and it gives it a vector coordinate which exists in this space, right? So you can imagine, like, at the top of this space here, maybe there's dogs, and then at the bottom there's trees and all of these different classes and things it has learned from. What I love about this concept as well is that there's an area of machine learning called unsupervised deep learning. And for me, there's a certain queerness. And when I say queerness, I mean an otherness away from normativity, from the norm, from normal. It's this in-between space. Instead of binary, instead of male and female and old and young, you can have these spectrums. And the latent space allows for this. So if you're training it on different human identities, for instance, you can move through this space and move through these vector dimensions, and it can kind of create these in-between spaces, which I think is a really beautiful concept. You could also plot the whole of language in this space and start to understand, like, the meanings of words as mathematical, like reduced to mathematical coordinates, which I think is like this extraordinary philosophical idea, maybe goes back to Wittgenstein's language games or something. So the second concept that I'm gonna briefly describe, which I think you might've already heard before as well, but is this idea of a generative adversarial network, which is the basis of how a lot of deepfake technology works. And this is this idea of creating a simulacra, a fake image that doesn't exist in the original data set, but you're tricking the algorithm into thinking this is an image that could have existed in the original data set. And the general concept is that you start with a latent vector. So like I said, a space in this, a point in this latent space, and you have a generator network that has not seen any real photographs, and it's pitched against a classifier network, like a network used for facial recognition that's been trained maybe on millions of images of human faces, and it knows exactly what to look for in a human face. And effectively, the generator hasn't seen those images. And what it does is it starts with random noise, and it gets better and better iteratively. The machine is learning to create a photographic representation of a human face. So these are the two ideas that for me really sparked something and wanted me, got me to really want to explore this field of machine learning as an artist, and in a way take these techniques that have been created and then look for the poetry in them, look for the criticality, look for the mistakes. I think as an artist, it's a fantastic opportunity that you can take a step back and you don't have a purpose. You don't have a function in the same way that the scientists have to create these algorithms to do something quite specific. You can step back and embrace the mistakes and the poetry and hack this technology to do something it wasn't originally intended to do. So the first piece that I'm going to briefly show is actually one of the first artworks I created using machine learning, artificial intelligence technologies. It's a reference to Namjoon Paik's TV Buddha, which is a beautiful piece of early video art, early media art, where it's a Buddha looking at the reflection of itself in a CCTV camera. So it kind of becomes this conceptual loop, right? I was working with a German artist, Roland Arnold, and we had this idea that what if we recreated this piece and updated it for a artificial intelligence to be generating a representation of the Buddha? And we trained a network on, I think, about 5,000 images of the Buddha. But the thing is, 5 years ago when we created this work, which is probably longer now, like 6 or 7 years ago when we created this work, our laptops weren't powerful enough to be creating a realistic representation of the Buddha. And our data set wasn't large enough. And the technology was quite primitive, so you could only generate very low resolution images. So what came out was these, which for us was a failure. You know, it hadn't achieved in creating a representation of the Buddha, but for us there was a real poetry in that, in the failures and mistakes of the network. What you're seeing here is the sort of guts, the artifacts inside a machine learning algorithm. And again, like I say, I think it's these failures that really intrigue me. So we had the Buddha staring at an artificial intelligence which had been trained on thousands of images of the Buddha but had failed to comprehend the image of the Buddha. It's an AI in its infancy trying to generate a representation of something. So this was one of my first experiments with these algorithms. Another piece that I want to briefly describe to you is another fairly early piece that I created using these algorithms. And it actually showed in a few museums around China. I think it showed in the Tank Museum in Shanghai, this piece. It's called Closed Loop. When I first got into machine learning, I was really interested in this idea that I could remove myself as the artist from the work. And what happens if I give agency over to these networks? I think as my thinking has developed over the last few years and my research has developed, I've realized that in fact, that's a bit of a mystification. I think when we speak about artificial consciousness and some of these sorts of concepts, sometimes it can be a bit of a distraction from some of the more political issues or policy issues or technical issues that are facing us. But anyway, in this work, I was quite interested in this idea. And what I did was I paired an image generating algorithm against another algorithm that labeled what it saw in images. So you can see here, it's saying in this image, it sees a large piece of paper. Now it's going to try and generate an image from scratch of what it thinks a large piece of paper looks like. When it settles on what it thinks a large piece of paper might look like, it then goes back and the first AI says what it now sees in the new image, a bird flying in the air. And now it's going to try and create an image of a bird flying in the air. So this was when these algorithms were really quite primitive. And for me, there's something lovely about that materiality, the fact that you kind of see the flickering, and it's almost like seeing this algorithm try and think and dream up new images. But of course, these algorithms, you know, the one on the left here has been trained on ImageNet, which is an open source data set containing 14 million images. And it's actually really quite primitive, quite basic, quite stupid. It only understands the limitations and bias of its knowledge, of its latent space, is completely contained within the data set that it has originally been fed, as with the language model, the words which it has been taught by us. So in a way, this is just reflecting back at us what we have given it. And because this is quite an early algorithm, it's not generating hyper-realistic images. So it is getting lost and it's sparking off in different directions and seeing different things to what was inputted in the first place. So now I'm going to whiz forward a little bit to a much more recent work of mine. Ever since I was a child, I've been going to the Essex Marshes, to the British coastline, which is it's a tidal landscape made up of estuary and marshland. And you get an incredibly diverse range of marsh birds, of wading birds. And they're wonderful, these birds. It's a bird reserve, and it's a very special place to me. With these techniques, I'm really interested often in recontextualizing and reframing these algorithms. So this work here, I was interested in taking something super artificial, like the most advanced algorithm we have right at the moment for creating synthetic deepfake images trained on marsh birds from this landscape, and placing it into that landscape to have a conversation with the wildlife in that space. So this is me going out into the mud, into the marshes with an LED. Well, I had a projection screen and I just plonked it into the mud. And then I'll play you a little extract of the video now. So here is a little bit of cusp. I don't know if you can hear the audio, but hopefully you can hear some sounds. Actually see them. Sorry, wait 1 second. Just going to check. So yeah, if you can hear the original audio, if not, it's on the internet, on my website. But the sound here is actually all being generated also using machine learning. So there's, I think I gathered 16 hours of field recordings from this natural environment and fed it into a network which would generate new raw audio samples of bird sounds and bird songs. This piece is actually toured also around China. It showed in the MCAM and YUZ Museum in Shanghai, as well as the Today Art Museum and the Hyundai Motor Museum. So now I'd like to show a little bit of another work, which is maybe thinking from quite a different angle about machine learning and artificial intelligence. And this is thinking more about the power structures, who owns this data and who is dictating to us how these technologies are being developed. So here I've used IBM Watson's technique for transcribing audio, which is a machine learning technique. And I've used that to extract every time these tech gurus and these CEOs of large companies have said numbers. So you get this reductive chain of Mark Zuckerberg or Elon Musk talking in just metrics. So I'll play a short extract of this. It's quite a fun, humorous piece.
5, 6, 5,000.
1 billion, 130 million, 100 million, 2 billion, 1, 200.
250, 71.
10,000, 150, 10,000, 18,000, 10,
16. 16. 350, 20,
2, 2, 2. 20,
350,
10, 15,
9,000.
9,000, 1,000.
1, 6 billion, 100 million, 100 million, 100 million, 600, 100 million, 1, 1, 10
billion,
5, 30 million, 1, 3, 2, 27 million, 2, 100.
1,
1,
5, 30,000, 0, 1,
10,
10,000, 10,000,
3, 3,
3, 400 billion, 1, 2, trillion,
382, 350,000,
350, 4, 4, 20,
10, 1, 3, trillion, 17, 400, trillions, 5, millions, 1, tens of thousands, millions, 500.
There we go. I'll stop there. You get the idea. So now moving on to, I guess, moving away from me, from just thinking about maybe appropriating other data sets and looking at the politics and biases of data sets which already exist, which I was doing quite a lot in my early work, and, you know, taking a data set, a public data set of 14 million images, and just using that to see what the technology can do and to try and find poetry in the mistakes of these algorithms. I think moving beyond that, I started to question representation in these data sets. So this piece here is called Querying the Dataset. And like I described before, it's about finding this otherness in between identities, and maybe thinking about the fact that a lot of facial recognition data sets, often gathered by American engineers, don't really contain a very diverse group of people. It's often really, you know, biased towards white men, especially. It often doesn't recognize Black women or trans people or queer people, people that don't fit into sort of normative notions of you know, how we tend to label humans. So with this piece, in London, I'm friends with a lot of drag performers. Drag performers, you know, being drag kings and drag queens, women that dress as men and perform with this and want to challenge, you know, society's notions around gender. It's not only gay men dressing as women, it can actually be much more expansive than that. I think it can really cross between genders and sexualities, and it's much more a way of being expressive and kind of playing with ideas of identity and gender. So what I did for this piece was, all of these faces you're seeing right now are synthetic faces. They've been created using machine learning, and they don't exist. They're morphing between and through this latent space of otherness. For this project, the starting point was a standardized dataset, which is CelebAHQ. It's a large dataset of 40,000 images of quite generic normative faces, quite homogenous faces and looks. And it doesn't really contain, you know, very expressive otherness, performers and artists and people that really like to play with ideas around identity. So what I did was, I took this standard data set and I injected those 40,000 images with 1,000 new images of drag performers, of drag kings and drag queens and club kids and people who do extraordinary makeup. And this is what happened. It's changed this neural network. It shifted the weights inside this neural network from a space of normativity into a space of queerness, into this kind of strange other, these monstrous, you know, bodies. And I think that's something that's really exciting, is how can we kind of explore otherness and queerness and creativity, like creating these unusual new identities through this algorithm. And also thinking about the fact of, do we want to be seen by these algorithms? Is it a good thing for these algorithms to understand all different identities and people that maybe stand outside of social norms and conventions? Or is it something that we do want to be included in? And I think there's, you know, this constant questioning there as well. So this is the piece that came out. And I think, like you can see, it doesn't really understand boundaries between gender and between race. And it's just constantly flowing in between them. And it gets very confused on the sort of makeup areas of some of the drag performers. So moving on from that, I wanted to think about, how can I actually start to control these performers, because they are performers. They work on a cabaret stage, and working with some of my friends from this community, I wanted to think about how we could use deepfake technology as a performance tool. And deepfakes are often used for exploitation, right? They're often used to create fake pornography or fake news and things which often exploits people, or, you know, uses as the subject people in positions of power. But for us, taking a more oppressed community, a marginalized community, and basically reclaiming this technology and subverting deepfake technology to empower ourselves and create a performance tool. So to do that, we had to create these deepfakes. So I filmed 13 different performers, and this is how we created one performer. So you film to create a deepfake of someone, and you film them from every different angle. You create your data set, then you convert those images into skeletons. So it understands that body as just a reduced to 64 points, a skeleton. And this is Lily Snatchdragon that you can see right now creating a deepfake of Lily. She's a wonderful cabaret performer in the UK. She's won awards for being one of the best cabaret and burlesque performers. So then what we do is we feed in those images into a neural network and try and create a realistic new image of Lily that didn't actually exist in the first place. It's quite a confusing concept to get your head around, but like I explained before about generative adversarial networks, this is effectively the same thing. You have an image up at the top left, but the neural network can't see that image. It's just being given a score, and it has to try and get as close as possible to that original image. But what it is given in this instance is the skeleton. It's given the shape of the body, which it's trying to use to create a new realistic image. So you can see it's getting better and better. The score is improving until we have really quite a realistic image of Lily. Once you have that realistic image, it's baked into the bottom. You can then feed in any new skeleton. Anyone can come along, move their arms around, and control that person's body. So this is what we've done. We've created these deepfakes that can be controlled. And if you go, so yes, this is Lily. We had a close-up model as well. What we then did is we worked with multiple different performers to create different styles of movement. And online, you can switch between these different performers. And the idea behind this is partly to demystify this technology, this deepfake technology. It's so that you can see the skeletons behind these bodies, and you can switch these bodies as they're performing to you to see that they are just fabricated, they're constructed bodies. And there's something quite interesting about this as well, because drag is all about constructing a fake identity. It's not a real identity. And deepfakes are all about constructing a fake body, right? So on our website, you can switch between these bodies, and we're hoping to effectively construct and then deconstruct these bodies and play with this, like, maybe notion that humans have, that AIs are human-like, which can be quite a problematic idea. And in a way here, we're kind of making fun of that idea slightly, that, you know, an AI is never really going to take over from a human performer. These are some combinations where I've combined all 13 performers into single bodies, and it's trying to make sense and combine different sections of these bodies. So you can visit this work and you can experience it and switch between these different bodies that we created on zz.ai. ZZ is our drag character's name. I'm just wondering how we're doing for time. We're getting quite close. I'm going to play a 20-second extract, the last thing in my presentation. This is a project which extends from this, but it's thinking about how can we work with a human performer alongside their deepfake clone. And for this, we're playing with musical theater tropes. And the song that we've chosen, as you'll hear, is all about the AI trying to outsmart the machine, the human. So it's a song called Anything You Can Do, I Can Do Better, from a musical called Annie, Get Your Gun. And it's all about this competition between the AI and the human, which is a bit of a satire of maybe how we view artificial intelligence as a society. So here's a short extract of ZZ and me performing Anything You Can Do, I Can Do Better.
Any note you can sing, I can sing higher.
I can sing any note higher than you.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
sing that high?
I'm a girl.
Anything you can say, I can say softer.
I can say anything softer than you.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can. Yes, I can. Yes, I can. Yes, I can.
Anyway, there we go. I'm going to finish on that. But thank you so much.
Thank you, Jake.
You want to start? I go.
Okay. So I have a question regarding your creativity. I would like to know how much you feel constrained by this kind of tool that you are using. I mean, I'm talking about AI, I'm talking about machine learning, I'm talking about GANs.
Mm-hmm.
How much you feel constrained?
Interesting question. I think it's definitely a constraint. I think that's what makes it interesting for me. It's about seeing the output that comes out of this tool. And I would say it is a tool. I think often we want to assign agency to this thing and say it's maybe capable of doing creative moves. And I think maybe that is an interesting debate, but I think the most interesting thing comes out of when we are collaborating with this very cold, sterile calculating machine. And as humans, we bring our creativity into that. So that's why working with performers, you know, who are doing extraordinary makeup, drag performers, and you know, taking creativity from the human and then feeding it as in this cold machine. I think that is something that's really interesting to me. And yeah, it's totally constrained. It fails so often, and that really excites me. It's, you know, with a machine learning algorithm, if you're training it on a data set, it's only as smart as what it has seen in that data set. So when I work with some of these performers, and you know, suddenly in the performance they lean over to the side, the machine learning algorithm might not understand that at all. And instead what happens is the whole head falls off, right? You just saw some examples of that. And that really excites me. It's seeing those mistakes and me not knowing what's going to come out. You know, I always choose not to curate the output of these networks. I like to leave them totally uncurated. And that is because I like to see the actual artifacts that come out of the network. It's a conceptual piece of artwork to me. I embrace those constraints. And I think it would be a lot harder in a way if these technologies were completely perfect, because I think it's the failures and mistakes that make the interesting artwork sometimes.
And I have a second question, because you are an artist, sorry. So the next speaker will be Primavera De Filippi. And she's an expert about intellectual property. And I would like to know your opinion as an artist, you are an artist, about NFT. What do you think about? Because it's a very hot topic here in China.
I wasn't expecting it to go that way. I thought you were going to ask me about the copyright laws around using data sets in AI. But yes, with NFTs, absolutely. I'm just trying to work out what this technology could bring to art right now. I think it has massive potential to help digital artists, to democratize digital arts, to support artists and to empower them. But I also think there are a lot of issues that need smoothing out at the moment, such as the storage problem, the environmental problem, you know, authenticating the artist in the first place. I think there are some things that definitely need to be thought through a little bit more, but I think it's definitely exciting possibilities. But in terms of, yeah, IP, I think actually one of the more interesting questions for my work specifically might also be around the data sets and whether it's okay to be appropriating material that's often copyrighted. In a way, with the, you know, performers, I am thinking completely about consent. I think that's such an important question. But if I'm using a copyrighted dataset, which I have done in the past, I think there's some interesting questions that come up around appropriation in art. And I think, you know, in conceptual art, there's always been these questions around appropriation. But yeah, no, I think there are some fascinating questions. But obviously, with legalese, if we allow that for artists, then could that also mean the big companies can come and take artists' work and steal those and then create generative networks to recreate and regurgitate out work without, you know, crediting the artist as well? So it's a double-sided sword. Anyway, thank you for the questions.
I have one question, which is kind of strange. We've been debating with Filippo many times about what is that AI can do that we cannot. And many, many things come up. And then we reverse the question. What is that we can do that AI cannot? And strangely enough, the concepts that we come up with, we're not very proud of them. Most of them are what you're doing. Mistake, failure, accident, fake, lying. So my question is, because you're getting into this area, which is the opposite of what we expect. It's the thing that we have hold as dearly as possible. That's the only thing that no machine, no AI can ever take from us, because we can lie the best that anybody can ever do. And yet, you come up to tell us that, you know what? Machines can lie too. So what do you think about that?
Absolutely. I think it's a really funny question, and I completely agree. I think it's pointing out, you know, how limited we are quite often. I think this is the thing. When I first started experimenting with creating these latent space visualizations, moving through this latent space of a data set of 14 million images, it created what looked to me like abstract expressionism. And actually, I get quite annoyed with often the conversation turning to painting, because I feel like, you know, it becomes a conversation that's just like, let's try and mimic painting. It becomes derivative. It's like, this is proper art because it's painting. But actually, on the flip side, what I was doing is I was taking a data set of 14 million photographs, and the data set, that the algorithm was creating something very painterly. And that was really exciting. And when I showed that at the Slade, quite a traditional art school, I had curators in. I had the curator of the Royal Academy come in, and he said, what is this? He's like, this isn't art. Like, I don't understand. I just don't understand it. He's like, you must have drawn some of these bits and you must have painted them. That's obviously a Picasso, and that's obviously a Francis Bacon. And he got quite wound up about it. And in a way, it's challenging humans to think about, what do we really do that's special? You know, what is human creativity? And we put it on a pedestal, but if we try and remove that, I think we get quite affronted and concerned by that idea. But yeah, I think machine learning has a huge potential to teach us more about our own consciousness. I think there's a risk of assigning intelligence and consciousness to these machines and talking about these machines in terms of philosophy of mind and singularities and these sorts of things, because I think it really mystifies the technology. But I think the flip side of that is that actually we can use this technology to understand our own brains a little bit better.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you so
Jack.
Much.
Okay. So
thanks, Jake, for accepting our invitation.
Okay. Now